Our second scripture reading is taken from the New Testament first letter of John. This is from chapter 3, and I'll be reading verse 16 through 24. Hear now the word of God. This is how we know love. Jesus laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. But if a person has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need and that person doesn't care, how can the love of God remain in him? Little children, let's not love with words or speech, but with action and truth. This is how we will know that we belong to the truth and reassure our hearts in God's presence. Even if our hearts condemn us, God is greater than our hearts and knows all things. Dear friends, if our hearts don't condemn us, we have confidence in relationship to God. We receive whatever we ask from him, and because we keep his commandments and do what pleases him. This is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love each other as he commanded us. And the person who keeps his commandments remains in God, and God remains in him. And this is how we know that he remains in us, because of the Spirit that he has given to us. And this ends the reading of Scripture. May God bless us with understanding upon hearing God's word. Amen. Well, it sounds like we've got another love chapter, Scripture. Love, you know, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. That's a pretty good formula, don't you think? It actually, you can find it way back there in Leviticus when God commanded the Israelites that that's what they should do. Is love your neighbor as yourself. And I think it is true that as far as formulas go, it's pretty good. It's worked for, you know, for thousands, in a variety of forms. In many of the world's religions, for example, as we just read, Jews believe that you shall love your neighbor as yourself, but they're not it. Hindus affirm this, that one should not behave toward others in a way which is disagreeable to oneself. Buddhists say this, they say that you should, quote, hurt not others in ways that you yourself would find hurtful. And Muslims believe that, quote, no one of you is a believer until he desires for his brother that which he desires for himself. So there's really no secret about this formula. It's been around a long time. I told you the story, you know, about the pastor who goes up to the pulpit, you know, Sunday after Sunday and says, love God, love neighbor, and sits down. And, of course, the congregation, as you remember, they get a little perturbed at this after a while. I mean, it was nice getting out early, but, you know, after a while. And so he says to them, you know, well, as soon as we get this one down, we'll move on. And sometimes it feels like that. We think love's a pretty good thing. Love God, love neighbor, it's great. We can get it down, great. We know Jesus endorsed it. He endorsed it. That's what he said. He made it a part of his great commandment. Love the Lord your God and love your neighbor as yourself. So what in the world is the writer of this letter in 1 John, what is he doing? Because he seems to be just kind of, you know, messing with the formula. Just a little bit. But there he is, and he does that. So what in the world is going on? Here's what he says. He says this new formula. This is God's commandment, that we should believe in the name of God's Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another. Trust in Jesus and love one another. Trust in Jesus and love one another. Now, that's not quite the same old formula. It's a little different. And we know this much. We know that, for example, in companies change formulas of their products. Even if it's just a little bit, it can cause some real upheaval. And I mentioned in the newsletter that, you know, Janet, myself and our daughter Amanda, we love this Coke. We don't drink a lot of soda, but when we do, we get Coke Zero. Okay. They changed it, and now it's Coke Zero Sugar. zero sugar. Okay. With a little change of the formula. People were not happy. Now, I tried it. I really can't tell much of a difference between the two. But our daughter, oh my goodness. Oh, she was outraged by this. You're changing the formula. And this wasn't the first time that Coca-Cola got into trouble. Back in 1985, do any of you remember that little fiasco? When Coca-Cola changed its original, been around forever formula with a product that was called New Coke. And they just expect, you know, oh, sure, it's New Coke. Everybody did. Well, what was the response to that? Oh, no. Oh, no, 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 no. It was overwhelmingly negative. And it was, I think, about 3 months that went by. And guess what came back? The original. The original Coke. How bad was that change, that tweak of the old formula? Well, the company hotline, which is kind of all you had. You didn't have emails and tweets and everything like that back then. So the company hotline received what were 1,500 calls a day. You may say, is that a lot? Is that not a lot? It was four times what they usually had. And they had psychiatrists and psychologists that were actually listening in on these calls, and they heard people talking as though they were grieving the death of a family member. Because their Coca-Cola was gone. And it's now New Coke. And so the bottom line with that whole thing is be careful when you change a successful brand, right? You might end up breaking something that doesn't need fix, right? I mean, so maybe that's one of the warning things, but then we got to ask again the question, what in the world is the author here of 1 John up to? What was the whole need for that? Well, I think for starters, he puts a human face on the commandment to love one another. And that face is the face of Jesus. And he says this, he says, we know love by this, he says, that he laid down his life for us. Because I think maybe John knows that the problem with the love commandment, just as the problem with the, you know, our songs about, you know, you think the world would have had enough of silly love songs, you know, the Paul McCartney. So, I mean, we have, it can become very saccharine, very syrupy, kind of little sweet little stuff. Oh, it's love. Oh, it's love. Love is sweet. It is enjoyable. It is pleasant. Love is tender emotions and charitable thoughts. And so, John changes the formula to include what was a bitter sacrifice. Sacrifice. Sacrificial of Christ on the cross. Oh, it's just a little change of ingredients, but it's monumental. And it's a change that can actually change our lives as well. He says this, he says, we ought to lay down our lives for one another. We have to have the same kind of sacrificial love is what we're called to. That's the kind of love that 1 John is talking about, that sacrificial stuff. And under what is this new formula, sacrificial giving, sacrificial love becomes central to our lives as followers of Christ. Here's what John asks his followers here. He says, how does God's love, this is kind of a rhetorical question, how does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods, who has stuff, and sees a sister or a brother in need and yet refuses to help? And of course, the answer is, where do you see God's love? Where do you see it? You don't. You just don't. Because love is seen in our actions, not in our words. And so John T. summarizes this new formula with these words, believe in the name of God's Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another. Linking now, trust in Jesus with love for one another, knowing that the examples of love is indeed that sacrificial living. It is not about what's in it for me. It's not about my agenda. It's about how can I give? How can I give away that which I have received from God? It is about that sacrificial life and the death of Christ. And the result of that whole new formula that he kind of lays out there is now this renewed connection to God that abides now and then. And John says that we'll know that God lives in us by the Spirit that God has given us. It is that new link now between trust and love and life. It is a Christ life. And oddly enough, I think I'm picking on Coca-Cola, but besides that, Coke actually has another product that is out there, semi-new, and it's a new version that's called, you may have seen it, it's in green cans. Have you seen this thing in the store? It's called Coca-Cola Life. That's what it's called. And it's there, it was first, I think, marketed in Argentina, went round to the United Kingdom, and finally here arrived in the States. And people, I know, because I wondered this, when you look at this green can of Coca-Cola with the word life on it, is this a healthier version of regular Coke? And it contains sweeteners from natural sources. So that's, I guess, regular Coke, I think, has 140 calories a can, and a life, something like 89, so much healthier. Coca-Cola has recently started offering life. Jesus has been offering life for quite some time. And throughout John's gospel, we hear it over and over again in the gospel about life. And in fact, the gospel was written, we know this one, so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have what? Life. The gospel begins with what is the Word of God, taking this human form of Jesus, and the Word becomes flesh. And we are promised that what was coming into being in him was life. And that the life was the light of all people. There you have it. Trust, life, light, ingredients all combined together into what is a new formula that is beginning to emerge. And then John goes on to tell us that God so loved the world that God gave the only Son, that whoever believes in him may not perish but may have eternal life. So there is love in the mix. There is life in the mix. A life that extends beyond the moment. A life that extends beyond a grave. And describing himself, Jesus said this. He said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. And I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Life in his name. Life, eternal life. The light of life, abundant life. The way, the truth, and the life. It is indeed a Christ life. And it's not the same old formula. It is love, but it is sacrificial love, the kind that is based upon giving it away and not hoarding it with oneself. We are called to give that a try because we have nothing to lose and we have everything to gain. All glory be to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.